Welcome. My name is Christina Nori. I plan these membership events. We want to thank you for joining us this evening and for being a subscriber. We couldn't do it without you. If you enjoy this event, be sure to check out sfchronicle.com/membership, where you can see our upcoming events and offers, as well as a full library of our previously recorded events. We encourage you to ask questions during this event. You can do that by using the Q&A module below, and I will relay as many as I can to Tara. So this evening, we have a Chronicle Assistant Food Editor, Tara Duggan, joining us. She's going to show us how to prepare crab because it can be a little tricky. So welcome, Tara.
Thank you, Christina. Hi, everybody. Thanks for coming tonight, and thanks for being a subscriber. I'm here in my house in San Francisco, actually with my daughter, Dahlia.
Hi.
She's helping out. And, Christina suggested we do this event, which is a great idea because we noticed in the food department that anything we write about Dungeness crab is extremely popular online. Those stories do incredibly well with our readers. I think there's so much interest in crab, and not only cooking it, but what's going on with the season. This season was a tough one. It started really late. We missed the holidays, but one thing that is kind of helpful to know, it's helpful to know how to cook live crab, because sometimes it can be a better value than cooked crab, and it also, you can be sure that it's fresh. You know, so I do sometimes buy the already cooked crab, but once in a while I've noticed when I buy a cooked crab, if it's been sitting in the case for a little bit, it's not as sweet, it might be a little dry. So I've kind of gotten the habit of the last several years of almost always cooking it myself. It is a little bit of a production, but it's really not too bad, as you'll see. Some of you have probably done it before. There are different methods for it. I'm going to show you the boiling method because that's what I do and it's kind of what I'm comfortable with. But we do have a link I'm going to ask Christina to add to the chat, which has a story with, or a post online that has a bunch of different crab recipes. And at the top, it has the basics for preparing crab. I'm going to go into a lot more detail. Yeah, Christina just added it. I'll go into a lot more detail here, but that gives you sort of this the real basics in terms, and including like the cooking time and things like that. I just wanted to say that I grew up eating crab and holidays in the Bay Area. I often say, like, if I had to pick a last meal, it would be Dungeness crab. And seems like there's a lot of other people out there with similar feelings, and I'm glad to see such a good show of people today. I've also had the opportunity of covering the crab season in the Bay Area for about 5 years, and there's been a lot of interesting stuff that has happened over those years, including algae blooms that came from warm water that lingered in the area during El Nino. And there have been more recently, actually those warm waters caused more whales to migrate into the crab fishing areas during crab season. And normally they leave, but because of warming waters, they've changed their migration patterns. And that's the main reason that the crab season was delayed this year, is to prevent whales from getting tangled in crab gear. And so there's a lot of complicated factors with crab. And let's see, yeah, as Christina mentioned, if you have any questions along the way, please go ahead and put them in the chat and she will ask me to answer them as we're going. I did want to say, a crab will be harmed in the making of this video. I'm going to show you how to cook a live crab. In case that sounds upsetting, just want to make sure you knew that. And I think that's it. And thank you again. And I hope you check out more of our events and suggest ones that you want to do. So I'm going to start by showing you how to cook the crabs. We're gonna move over to the stove. And I'm gonna make sure my video is working here. Let's see. Okay. So let's see. Maybe I haven't addressed buying the crab. Hopefully most of you have access to a store that sells live crab in a tank. A lot of Asian seafood markets specialize in live crab, or even Asian supermarkets. So like Ranch 99 and some other stores like that will have tanks of live crab. Lower the camera, okay. And what else? Depending on where you live, there are other places that sell crab. For example, Half Moon Bay, you can buy crabs from the boats. In Fisherman's Wharf, you can't buy a crab from the boat, but there are places like Alioto Seafood that have a lot of live crab. I actually ordered the crab today from a newer company called Four Star Seafood and paid extra. Okay, the volume is too low. Not sure how to do that. Maybe I'm not close enough to the camera. While I'm talking, I'll try to be closer. Does that help? Can somebody?
That's good. That's a little louder.
Okay. Thank you. That's great. Okay. This one company, Four Star Seafood, delivers to your house, and I didn't want to worry about tracking down crabs today. So because they have been a little bit harder to find this season. So I ordered them. It cost extra $20 to deliver it, but it was worth it. We also recently actually ran a story about where to buy crab, and we can post a link to that as well if that's helpful. So the first thing I do when I'm cooking crab is I get my biggest pot, which is probably this one, and I fill it up most, you know, 2/3 of the way with water. I also add enough salt to be like seawater, because the crab come out of the ocean, and if you throw them into a pot that's of water that's not very salty, you could lose quite a bit of flavor, because they're going to leach some of the salt through osmosis into that water. So I actually added, I just poured salt, you know, for a while. And I think it was maybe a cup. Depends on how much water you have. I would recommend tasting it and see if it tastes kind of like a mouthful of seawater. I know. I'd almost give you a little saltier, but it's about right. I get that water going really at a high boil to try to put the crab out of its misery as soon as possible. That's also why I also usually only cook one at a time to make sure the water comes back to a boil really quickly, because once you add the cold crab to the water, it cools the water down. So
is there a reason that you boil versus steaming them?
You know, that's just kind of my comfort zone for whatever reason. Steaming is great, is also a good method. You need to have a big enough pot to steam. And I know a lot of people like to add flavors to their steaming liquid too, or maybe a little rice wine, depending on what kind of flavor you're looking for. I'm just kind of in the habit of boiling. I think steaming would be a lot less water. It takes a similar amount of time, and the link that we use, that we included, tells you one recipe for steaming. That reminds me, I also don't tend to put any flavors in the water. Some people like to put Old Bay or lots of different seasonings. I just find that's kind of unnecessary. I think the crab has so much flavor. I want to just focus on that. And I haven't noticed a great deal of flavor added to the crab when I've done that. So one trick you can do when working with live crab, and I can be a little wimpy about it, to be honest, is put it in crab. You hopefully have a pretty lively crab because you want them to be alive. But if you put it in the freezer for 15 to 30 minutes before you cook it, kind of mellows the crab out. It's not going to claw at you while you're bringing it into the pot. So I did do that for this one. And I'll show you the the best way to hold the crab, because in case you're not going to do that. Either way, it's a good thing to learn. I'm going to grab it out of the freezer. Yeah, it's starting to wake up, but you want to put your hands under like that, and you can see he's trying to get to me, and your fingers. This crab actually has some rubber bands, so it's not as mobile with its claw, but maybe I'm going to go ahead and put this in there. I'll show you later with another crab. Okay. So I had that water at a really high boil. I covered it so that the water will hopefully return quickly to a boil. And generally what we say is 7 minutes per pound for boiling. I think steaming is a similar amount of time. It's already almost come back to a boil. I usually wait for it to come back to a boil for this timer to start. Someone asked how big that crab is. Hi Lisa. I didn't get a chance to weigh this crab, but which normally would be a good idea, but I didn't. I think this one feels a little over 2 pounds. I'm going to say 2 1/4 because that's 15 minutes.
And we have a question about the salt. So if someone doesn't have kosher salt, is regular table salt fine?
Yeah, that's totally fine as long as you get that nice salty water going. You can use any kind of salt. All right, so I've set the timer for 15 minutes, and after that, I'm going to show you the next steps, but I'm going to show you how to clean it because we have one that's already prepared in advance.
And do you ever kill before you put the crab in the water? We have some questions about that.
Some people, there are different ways of killing a crab. You can use a knife, but it's not very easy to do. I mean, it's kind of a chef, I would say someone with kind of really good knife skills would want to do that. I've never actually done it myself. Some people do that with lobster, but with Dungeness crab, it's kind of tricky because it has such a big shell and it also has a lot of, I've got this, can you get extra towel, please? So the problem is it's pretty hard to get in there and kill it with a knife. So boiling it kills it quite quickly. I don't really know any other way to do it. There are sometimes some crab purveyors will clean the crab. So they kill it and clean out the guts and sell it to you uncooked. So that's another possibility. But yeah, for me, this is sort of the easiest method and I think maybe the quickest method.
And would that be the best way to reduce the risk of disrupting the crab's gut?
You mean to kill it first?
Yeah, so we had someone about asking about the way to reduce the risk.
Can you turn that down? Mm-hmm. Yeah, you mean if you want, I'm not sure if you're asking if you want to do that to preserve the guts to eat them, or if you just don't want it mixed up with the rest of the crab. Maybe we can get back to that's a little more advanced question. But yeah, when you boil the crab, the guts are kind of, as I'll show you in a second, they are kind of all mixed up into with the crab. Okay, so let's move the camera. Was there anything else about cooking that we want to talk about that anyone had questions about before we move on?
We have some questions about storing it beforehand. So if someone gives gets a fresh crab as a gift, like what's the best way to store it in the refrigerator before they're ready to cook it?
So yeah, you should cook it the day you get it, but you can keep it in the refrigerator. This one, for example, was in a box with some padding and it was fine. I had it in the refrigerator for several hours. You could eat, you know, a lot of times you get it in a plastic bag and you can go ahead and stick that in the refrigerator. You don't want it to be there too long because you don't want it to suffocate. So I would loosen the bag a little bit. But yeah, you should definitely, if you get it as a gift, you should cook it the day you get it. You can also freeze cooked crab and it actually freezes pretty, very well. And then there are ways to, sometimes people recommend just steaming it to get it back to temperature afterwards. I haven't actually done it myself, but I've been hearing that from, for example, one of the writers we work with does her own crab fishing. Her name's Momo Chang. And she told me she's been freezing a lot of crab because people keep gifting her crab when she goes fishing because people catch a lot and they have too much. Is there another storage question?
Well, so we have one about steaming. Do you need to salt the water if you're steaming? This viewer uses vinegar when steaming.
You know, I don't think you have to worry you don't really have to worry so much about, you can add a little salt for flavor, but it's not the same thing because you're not plunging it into a big pot of water where you would have that issue with the water, the salt leaching out of the crab.
Because it's not, osmosis isn't happening when it's steamed because it's not surrounded by water. That is a different salt level.
Right, exactly. So steaming is a little different. Thank you.
And are you worried about the rubber bands in the water? Does the rubber leach when you're boiling?
I wasn't too worried about it. The rubber bands are kind of a fancy thing that this four-star seafood does. Most places don't have them. I decided not to worry about it myself. But if you had a concern, the tricky part would be getting it off the claws. I actually meant to ask four-star about that because I've never seen the rubber bands before this. But you could probably ask them not to put the rubber bands on if you want. But they are kind of handy. Again, before I forget, I want to show you the method for holding a live crab. This is not a live one, but if you get your finger down here, which is the bottom of the crab, actually this is kind of its reproductive organs right here. Oh, can everybody hear me?
I can still hear you.
Okay, and then you can put your fingers on the top. That way the big claws can't really reach you. The other one was trying to, but you can't, you'd have to have them like looking right at your face to get them to get you at this point. Okay, I'm gonna keep going with the cleaning, but we can always come back to more questions later too, and feel free to ask or hang on to those questions. Okay, so one thing I didn't mention yet, but I know some people like to keep the guts from the crab. Or the guts is not the nicest way to say it, but the tamale is one word, the mustard, crab, it's the crab's liver and pancreas, I believe is what is often eaten. In years where there are issues with domoic acid in the water, you don't want to eat the liver, the crab mustard, as it's also called. But this year is actually not at all a problem, and I started using it this year. One person described it as it tastes a little bit like sea urchin, which I thought was a really good description because I think it's eating the same type of food that sea urchin eats. So it does have that really delicious, almost like an abalone flavor. And I like to add it to drawn butter, but not everyone's into it. I just wanna say that that's gonna come up in the demonstration. So the first thing you can do, first thing I usually do, some people do this differently, is I find the apron, and this is this triangular part underneath the crab, and I take that part off. I did forget to tell you, because we're kind of doing this backwards, because I cooked this earlier. It's after you cook the crab, you're gonna wanna cool it off so that you can clean it. So what we did was we ran this under some cold water, and we also put a little bit of ice in a bowl of water to cool it off. So after I've removed that part, the next step seems kind of hard to do, but it's actually pretty easy. Once you kind of get used to it, you want to go to the back of the crab, and you're going to feel, it's almost like there's a little cavity right there. You're just going to gently pull it off, and it might be hard at first, but then it'll give. If you want to save any of those crab goo, you might just kind of flip it over like that. That's okay. I got going here, because that way it's all right in the shell. The neck, I've never done this as a demo before, so I'm trying to do this step by step. So I'm going to set this part aside. Now what we have here is the lungs and some of the other organs from the crab. They're very soft and kind of squishy, and they have a similar color to the meat, but you'll notice when you clean them that they come off really easily. And they feel different than the meat. The meat is buried it's buried inside the shell anyway, but sometimes, I remember when I first started doing this, I was kind of confused about the different parts involved. So you wanna try to take those lungs off. Oh yeah, you can turn that off. And if you wanna save any more of this tamale, it's kind of resting here. There are different ways to do it. You can scoop it off. This is the orange kind of custardy looking stuff. Some people are probably like, that's disgusting, I'm never gonna eat that. But some people love it. I do really think it's delicious. There's also some crab fat there. You can kind of shake it to get some of that out. And then later we can just rinse, we're gonna rinse this off too. So don't worry. Okay. Save some of it. I didn't do an amazing job of that, but that's okay. So once I've gotten all these lungs off, does it look like you can see well on the camera? Yeah, okay. The next thing you do is take off the little, mouth, which is at the front. And this actually comes off really easily, as you'll notice. You can just use your fingers to crunch it off. And you might have to do a little picking. All right, I actually have a bowl of water here, so I'm just gonna rinse this really quickly, but you can run it under cold running water to get some of the last parts off.
Would you like me to rinse it?
That's okay, it just takes a second.
All right.
And again, this stuff isn't bad for you. It can't, and during seasons where there's issues with water, you know, safety, the health department actually tests the guts of the crab and lets the public know if it's safe to eat or not. So I've talked to a lot of these health department folks myself, and I feel like they're extremely conservative about safety. So I would trust them personally. I think it's totally safe to eat it right now. Okay, so the next step, now we've got basically the good stuff is left. This one claw accidentally popped off, but there are different ways to do this. I'm gonna show you I'll show you a couple things. This is the body of the crab, and it's actually quite easy to break it in half. Well, I say that, I'm gonna have to show you now. So you can kind of you don't have to use your hands, you can use a knife. You'll see there's a little bit of that tamale left. And the next thing you can do is grab a leg at the joint and try to twist it to save that joint, because that's gonna have some meat in it. It's okay if it doesn't, sometimes it's gonna just pop off without the joint, but that's okay. So you might, yeah, that's good. It's got a nice little nugget of meat. Should I take that one? Oh, is that the timer?
Yeah. Oops.
Oh, no, this one still has 3 minutes.
Okay, yeah. Oh, yeah. We almost forgot about our crab in there. We have different timers going. Okay. So that's very satisfying when you twist it and it comes right out. I'm going to do a few more just so you can see it. Sometimes people actually like to cut the body.
Grab a knife.
That big one's good. Some people like to cut it into sort of serving sizes, like so that you get a little bit of body and a little bit of leg with it. That's another way to do it. I just like to have them separated, just kind of the traditional way that I do it myself, maybe how I was brought up. And there you go.
Should I bring the platter over so we can plate it? Or
yeah, let's see if it, right now, are there any questions so far about this process before we move on?
No questions about this process so far.
Okay,
cool. I'm gonna just tell.
Sure, thanks, Carolyn. Oh yeah, before I do the next thing, I think the crab is almost done. So we're gonna go back and I'm gonna just show you, it's not that big a deal, but just how to get the crab out of the pot because it's a little unwieldy. So let's move over here.
Okay. Remember to talk loud.
Okay, I'm gonna make sure I talk loud so you can hear me. Okay, we've got 20 seconds left. Okay. There are, you know, I have heard steaming crab keeps it a little juicier than boiling it. I need to do some little more experiments myself. I tend to be really traditional with crab. I don't know, it's just one of those things. But it is possible to undercook it as well. So try to get it, try to find out the weight so that you can get the right amount of cooking time. And if it's undercooked, the body is going to be a little too soft. If that happens, you could actually throw it in a steamer for 5 or 10 minutes. That's probably a little better than throwing the whole thing, the body, back into the boiling water. I feel like, I don't know, maybe you could try that, but I feel like it might be a little too delicate to boil once you've cleaned the crab. Okay, this is a much bigger crab than the other one. I think I'm going to cook this a little bit longer because it looks bigger. And I cooked that last one for 15 minutes. I'm not doing this very scientifically.
You have to, you're feeling it.
And yeah, how long do you let it cool before you start to crack it?
So mostly just till it's cool enough to handle. I'm adding like 2 more minutes. So if you used a big bowl of ice water, if you used a big bowl of ice water, that would probably be the fastest way. But if you stick it under cool running water in a colander and just let it cool off, that's fine. I know I said, you know, you don't want to use regular water, but at this point, I think it's kind of gotten its flavor in there. So it's probably okay. And yeah, you just want to cool it off till it's not too hot to handle. And yeah, I have tried to, one thing about crab is they're very slippery. So I grabbed a spider to help scoop it out. You could also just use like some kind of thing like this. Because they're heavy and they're full of water, you know, it's probably around 3 pounds at this point. If you try to just use tongs, it can be slippery and hard to handle.
And where can our viewers get that wire spoon?
This one, I think I got it in a Chinese or Asian market. I think I got it in Chinatown. But there are, it's used a lot in frying and other types of cooking. But like, there's also this, something like this you can use as well. even just a big spoon, just so you have some leverage, as long and you want to be careful with the hot
and
water.
Can you repeat the boiling time again?
Yeah, sure. It's in that link that we shared in the chat. It's 7 minutes a pound. So the tricky part is finding out how much it weighs, which you could probably assume most crab is somewhere around 2 pounds and maybe plus or minus quarter pound usually. Sometimes they're as big as 2.5 pounds. Okay, so I've used my big spoon to get it out, and then I'm just using this to kind of guide it. And remember, it's got a lot of water, so just be careful as you pull it out.
All right, should we go back over here?
Yeah.
Okay, we're moving back over here. Should I move this crab that's on the table onto here?
No, this is perfect, because okay. I'm gonna show them how to.
And after you place the crab in the pot and bring it to a second boil, do you reduce the heat to a simmer or are you boiling it on high?
Yeah, you know, you want it at a nice steady boil, especially like I said, when you first add the crab. After that, it's just make sure, you don't want it to go too low. I tend to boil it kind of at medium because I don't want it to accidentally go down too low because you might accidentally undercook it a little bit. So, oh yeah, could you pull off that crab, please? So Dolly's gonna go run that crab that we just cooked under cool water to cool it off. And yeah, it just takes about, you might wanna use the tray because it's all drippy.
Right.
It just takes about 5-10 minutes to cool it off until you can handle it.
And do you cover the pot while it's boiling?
I cover it when I first add the crab to get it back to a boil as quickly as possible. I'm just trying to make it kind of kill the crab as quickly as possible, basically. That's my theory anyway. I don't know if that's really true, but. All right, I'm gonna show you now one way to get the crab ready, depending on how you wanna serve it. I'm showing you sort of the traditional San Francisco Bay Area way of serving it with, you know, just with some maybe bread and drawn butter. And I like to make a homemade mayonnaise. I'll show you all that in a minute. But actually, that's kind of loud. Maybe just let it soak in the water.
Okay.
Yeah,
sorry.
Thanks. So when you buy crab that's already been cleaned and cracked, that means we've already done the cleaning part and we separated the legs, but one other part is just getting it ready to serve so it's easier for people at the table to eat with their hands. We can also talk about some other ideas for how to use the crab other than serving it this way, but I wanted to show you the sort of most traditional way first, at least in San Francisco, most traditional way. But once you've cooked it at this point, you can use it in a lot of different dishes. It's cooked, but it's not really gonna overcook it if you saute it, or if I have a recipe in that document that we shared for pasta, a spaghetti that I make sometimes where I take all the meat out of the body of the crab and then I leave the shells. I use cracked shells and toss them into the spaghetti sauce. It's really good. So there are a lot of things you can do at this point, but I'm showing you just the sort of standard how to serve it. So there are different tools you can use for cracking. And somebody recently recommended rolling pin, which is pretty handy. Although then your rolling pin might take on a new fragrance. and then a mallet works. So this is just to get the shells to be a little bit easier to access when you're eating it at the table. Because you're gonna serve this in the shell and everyone's gonna crack it themselves at the table. So all I'm trying to do is make it leave the meat in the shell, but make the shell easy to open up. So what I do with the legs is I put them straight up like this, not on their side, because that will kind of crush the meat, but I want to sort of hit the joint and the part of the leg that's easier to crack. So hold it like this and I give it a whack. I don't want to whack it all the way and smash everything. I just whacked it to give it that little crack. And you don't have to do this, by the way. This seems a little intimidating. You can still serve the crab without doing this, but it does help people eat it at the table. It makes it a little easier.
Especially when you have kids who are unseasoned crab eaters like myself.
Dahlia just started liking crab. I'm very proud of Dahlia for finally understanding. So you can do the same with the smaller side of the leg, like that. So you just give it a little whack. There, another thing some people do is whack it on the joint. Kind of like right here. I think the way I just showed you might be the easiest. Don't hurt yourself doing this. It's not worth it. So give it a little whack. So now the reason I'm doing that is, let's say I'm at the table. I've got my crab. Then I can just open it up, get that meat right out. And eat it. And dip. I'm going to dip this in some butter and some mayo. And then just eat it.
That's a nice one.
This is my favorite part of the crab, is that thigh. And then
to imagine a crab with a thigh.
Yeah. These are pretty chunky though. And then see, I can kind of easily crack this open. I can use a nutcracker or crab cracker to get that last little bit. And I think my grandpa showed me, you don't miss any of that crab. You want to get in there and get it all. So I eat every little bit. You don't waste it, especially because when I was growing up, they would get maybe one crab for the whole family. Okay, so I just wanted to show you that. And so I would go through, and that reminds me, when you're serving crab, you're definitely going to want to have a bowl for the chef.
Should I get you a bowl?
Yeah. I usually serve the... thank you. I usually just serve the bodies of the crab like a half or a quarter so that people can grab. Usually, it depends on how many crabs you have. You can divide it however you like. You can cut this in half with the knife if you like. So the body, I didn't do that very gracefully. That was not pretty. The body's a little harder to pick the meat out of, and I think I'll just go ahead and show you now. It's got these little cavities, and the meat from the body is actually great for if you wanted to do crab cakes. If you had leftover crab, I would try to save body meat as opposed to leg meat, because you can get a little bit more out of it, and it's a little faster to take the meat out than the legs. As you can see, the legs were kind of a process. It's got these little shell, very thin shells in between the meat. So you just have to kind of, it takes a while. That's why crab costs so much when you buy it already picked, because all the labor has, you know, somebody has to do this for hours at a time. But like I said, I normally just serve this at the table. I'm gonna go ahead and show you platter. When I'm cooking crab, I like to, and I don't waste any of this stuff, so I'm gonna save it. Let's see.
Show me to arrange it.
Yeah, sure. I'm gonna show you one more cracking, because I know that can be a little challenging. So one more. So yeah, if you happen to have any crab left over, which is unlikely, I would say, if you do, you can set it aside and use it for something else, like a crab cake, or even, I recently put it in an omelet, because I had just a little bit left, and it was incredible. It's delicious. Okay, so the big claws are a little bit harder to crack, but they're actually kind of, it is more helpful for your guests or your family if you do crack it. So again, I'm gonna kind of try to get a good angle on it this time. Oh, I just smashed it. That was not very impressive. These are harder because they're really thick. So one thing you can do is just give it a little, and then the person can pull it apart. And then they might need a little fork to scoop all that out. Okay.
Should I show them how our plate is looking so far?
Sure, let's move this.
This is our platter. We still have more crab to add, but we've got the pretty orange crab legs showing. We got some lemon, and this is the mayo, right?
Yeah, the mayo. So mayo.
You can take, here's the piece that mom separated before. You can dip it in here, or you can dip it in some butter. We have plenty of toppings at the table. I like the butter myself.
Yeah, some people like butter. I like either warm butter or mayo. Actually, I made some drawn butter.
I'm gonna bring it over there.
I'll just bring it over.
Okay. Can you scooch that over?
Yeah.
Should I move the camera up?
No, I think we'll just here. Okay. So
magic.
Yeah. So this is a little cute burner, double burner. I just put some, you don't have to do this, but I put water in the bottom so that I could serve it at the table. I sometimes do this with fresh herbs. I actually was out of fresh herbs, but I put some pink peppercorn in there, and I just let the butter warm for a while. You can put shallots, or you could put garlic. Just put the butter on really low heat and add some different aromatic things in there. I actually put a little dried dill in this one. And the nice thing about this double burner is that it keeps it warm at the table. We also have a small fondue pot with a candle that we use for warm butter to keep it warm, because once it cools off, it's not as delicious. So that's another possible topping for crab, or just dip for crab. And then we just serve it with some bread and maybe some roasted potatoes, because they're good with it, and a salad. Trying to think if we, so I'm sure we have lots more questions about how to prepare it. And Christina, do you want to run through some more?
Yeah, so once the crab is cooked, can they freeze it in the shell, or does it need to be taken out of the shell to be stored?
Oh, good question. You actually can freeze it in the shell, and I think that's a good way to do it. You can buy frozen whole crab at some stores. A lot of the big processors that buy crab from the fishermen, they freeze a whole bunch of it. It freezes surprisingly well. So yeah, you can keep it in the shell. And I personally, like I said, I haven't tried it at home, but I would assume, just want to make sure you cool it down all the way before you freeze it, dry it off, and maybe stick it in a bag or something in the freezer, and try not to wait too long to use it, but I bet it would hold at least a month or two in the freezer.
And have you tried to reserve the shell for cooking stock?
You know, I have done some crab stock before. It does, saved some of the cooking water, but that was, well, I didn't use as much salt when I did that. I'm not totally sure if the crab shell would give you a ton of flavor, but if you're making some kind of fish stock anyway, you give it a shot. See, I bet it'll definitely have some flavor. I forgot to mention, when you make the drawn butter that I showed you, last time I made that, I added some of the crab butter stuff into it, and it added just a little bit of depth of flavor to the butter. And so when you dip the crab in there, it almost gives it like extra crab flavor. So it was really delicious.
And can you tell us more about what you put in the mayo for dipping?
Oh yeah, so
thank you.
So there's a recipe from, I think the website Serious Eats popularized this mayo that's super easy to make. I don't know if any of you have tried it. You basically put, because I always have a hard time making mayo emulsify. It's pretty easy for it to fall apart when you're making it. So the easiest, this method, if you look up Serious Eats mayo, I think they call it like 3-minute mayo or something. You stick the raw egg and lemon and maybe mustard if you're using it. This one, I did use mustard, lemon, mayo. I didn't use garlic because it can be a little strong with the crab, even though I love aioli, it can overwhelm the crab. And then you put that in the bottom of a narrow jar and you whisk it with the immersion blender and some salt. And then you pour the oil on top without moving the immersion blender, and you start the immersion blender. And it just sucks the oil into the vortex and it becomes mayonnaise in like immediately. It's kind of amazing. So this is a pretty standard mayo with just a little mustard, lemon, and egg, and canola oil, not olive oil, for a lighter flavor.
And have you tried to put the crabs in at a lower temperature and slowly raise it so that they stay relaxed while it cooks?
I haven't done that. Isn't that the kind of lobster, that's what people do for lobster to keep it from realizing it's cooking? Or maybe that was frogs, I can't remember. But I've never tried that before. Yeah.
You prefer the quicker.
I kind of like the quick, just to get it over with.
Yeah.
Method. Yeah. Also, I think that also helps, it's sort of like when you're, it helps you determine how long you're cooking it so you don't overcook it. I think that would be the only downside with that other method, unless you had a recipe that was tested for that exactly.
And if you're cooking multiple crabs at a time, how do you kind of keep one ready so that they're all kind of served at the same temperature and you're not having to let them sit for too long?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. I actually meant to say that I usually do this in advance I like to just kind of have it done. And you can even chill the crab. Some people prefer cold crab. Some like it more at room temperature. So you could do this early in the day. You could make your crab. I like to kind of get it over with, get the pots out of the way because they're big pot and the guts and everything. So I tend to do it in advance anyway. So I like having one crab in the pot and one that I'm cleaning, and then finish that one and do the next one. So you could definitely cook them at the same time, but you're still gonna have to clean one at a time anyway. So it takes a little time. And you know, if you're doing a lot of crab, I've just been talking about two crabs. Some people buy a bunch for a family. I would get a friend or family member who's in it to help you with this process because it can take a little time.
And have you tried a method where you cook the crab but slightly undercook it and then you grill it or, you know, kind of char it?
You know, we have a recipe in that link. I'm going to look really quick. That I haven't tried myself, but I was very intrigued by. It was a recipe for a barbecue Dungeness crab. And I'm not sure if they undercook it or not. They might cook it slightly less. It was a chef's recipe. I'm just gonna find the name really quick so it's easy for you to find it. Oh yeah, it's a barbecue Dungeness crab with a trio of dipping sauces that, we ran a recipe for, and let me just see if they, you know what? That one was actually kind of an advanced crab because they don't cook it before they barbecue it. There are a lot of different methods that different approaches depending on how your comfort level, also with, you know, live crab versus, you know, how you're comfortable killing the crab and cleaning it. I wanted to show you one that I thought was kind of the most straightforward. But I've also noticed surprisingly that I haven't had a big problem with crab overcooking. Like when I've mostly used it in more sauteed recipes, like I said, like that spaghetti. I haven't really tried the grilling, but it sounds intriguing to me. So it could be worth a shot for sure. I think it wouldn't hurt if you're gonna do that to maybe undercook it 3 or 4 minutes, and you don't wanna undercook it too much because it might not get cooked evenly by the time you barbecue it.
And do you have tips on how to tell if a crab is done cooking?
You know, I don't think there's really a great way because it's so protected. There's no way to, I've never tried to do a thermometer test. That might be something some people do. But it's so, you know, the meat is hidden inside all the shells. I guess you could try taking one of the legs off if you really want to, but I like I said, I would probably err on the side of cooking slightly more myself because I haven't had a big problem with overcooked crab whenever I've done this. It's sort of, it seems to be kind of, it has enough fat to kind of withstand a slight overcooking.
Okay, and if you buy cooked crab so that you don't have to clean it yourself and you're steaming it, how long would you steam it just enough to warm it up?
Yeah, if it's already cracked and cleaned, really only about 5 minutes would probably be plenty to get it warmed up. And just, you know, get your steamer at a full gale and then add it, and then it shouldn't take that long.
And what does an overcooked crab look like?
It would just, the meat would be a little dry, I think. I think when you, see, this one is quite tender. I actually hope I didn't undercook it, but I think it's good. You probably can't really tell, but it almost is a little bit translucent. And I feel like when it's overcooked, it's more white and more
opaque.
Yeah, more opaque, more kind of dry looking. But honestly, the only time I've really had dry crab was when I bought crab that was cooked and it maybe was a little, I think it might have, maybe it was overcooked or maybe it was a little old, you know? So when I think when it's freshly cooked, you'd have to really cook it to mess it up. I think you'll just notice it's a little more dry when you eat it.
Okay, and some of our viewers feel like this might be too much work for them and they wanna know how big of a price difference it is to just buy the crab that's already cleaned.
And yeah, that's totally fair. So it actually isn't that much of a difference. It's probably, it really varies. Sometimes it's the same price. So I think I noticed, sometimes I've seen like $1 or $2 a pound difference. So if you know of a store near you that you trust and you know that they cooked the crab recently, that's great. You know, there's no problem with that. I do know that a lot of the big production of crab that gets caught is sent to a big processor where it gets cooked and then it's sent out to like the Safeways and the Costcos and things like that. So there is a chance that some of that has been sitting around longer than, you know, than ideal. So I would just make sure you find a store where you know they have quality and they refresh it often.
So basically like the payoff is, you know that it's fresh when you cook it yourself, and that's like the money that you get.
Yeah,
like in terms of flavor.
I think it's, you know, yeah, I think it's the process of knowing it's fresh, and then once you do it a few times, it starts to become a fun tradition too. And I think it's one of the few animals that I cook that's live, you know, and I think there's something to be said for that experience, just to see what that's like and to be more aware of what goes into your food. Not everybody needs that experience, but yeah, so, you know, it's not for everybody, but I think it's fun to learn how to do it, and it's worth it to try it for sure.
And do you have a recommendation for the best filler for crab cakes that doesn't make it too bready?
Yeah, that's always really hard with crab cakes. I know, because there are a lot of, one thing that is really good is fresh breadcrumbs instead of dried breadcrumbs. Another thing is, so if you can get your hands on fresh breadcrumbs, or if you want to make them yourself, it's not actually that hard to do. That just gives it a lightness, especially on the crispy parts of the crab cake. And yeah, I don't really have a particular recipe in mind right now, but it helps to not mix the crab too much. You use like a light hand when you're handling it. So it kind of just makes it more delicate overall. But I can try to find a good recipe for you. I kind of usually just do it on the fly, to be honest. I think it's usually like eggs, some seasoning, and then some breadcrumbs on the outside. It's pretty basic.
Okay, and we probably have time for just one last question. Do you know any East Bay locations where our viewers can buy freshly cooked crab right from the pot at curbside?
That's a good question. Sorry, I'm not so familiar with, I'm not sure which stores sell it cooked versus live. I don't know if Berkeley Bowl, for example, does it. So, Monterey Market is great, actually. If you have, you probably already know about Monterey Market, but that's in Berkeley. And they're owned by a wholesale company that has been around for decades that buys crab direct from fishermen and also has a retail store, and they sell both. I think Tokyo Fish also, which is also in Berkeley, sells both. So you can get, and I would trust both of them with fresh crab for sure. Do we have time for one or two more questions?
Sure. So do you advise against buying a dead crab to cook?
Yeah, I do. And I honestly don't even really know why, but I think it deteriorates pretty quickly, and I don't, unless you're buying it from someone who, for example, we actually get a delivery of seafood every 2 weeks from a company called Sea Forager. And sometimes they provide cleaned crab that has already been cleaned and killed. So it's basically, you know, the raw version of what I showed you, the clean crab, and then you steam that. The difference with that is they deliver that the day that you get it. They deliver it the day it's cleaned, and it's also been cleaned, so it doesn't have some of the organs are what break down most quickly. So you don't want a dead animal that's got all of its organs. It can deteriorate pretty quickly. I think that's the main reason you avoid it. So I guess it depends on how long it's been dead, really, but you want it to be very fresh.
And do you have any other recommendations for places to buy crab in the city?
Well, I usually buy it at Sunfat Seafood, which is in the Mission, just because that's nearby and they're really good quality seafood company. So I like to buy from them. They're actually temporarily closed right now, but there's another place across the street from them that's also been selling live crab. They're at 23rd and Mission. And there's so many places. I think I mentioned Alioto's. There's Byright Market sell cooked crab, and I think they do a nice job of their cooked crab. I used to buy from Tower Market or Molly Stone's in Twin Peaks, and it really depends on the neighborhood that you're in, but there are actually quite a few places to buy crab because it's so popular, but I would focus on places that really specialize in seafood. Makes sense. Brian's in Laurel Heights is another great place for fresh crab. I wish we had more time, and I wish I could show you more ways of cooking crab too. Maybe we need to do another class with more recipes.
You just want to eat more crab.
That's right. Now we get to eat the crab. I don't know if any of you cooked crab along. Did anyone there cook crab while they were watching this? I wonder. No. We could try to do that next time. Oh, cool. Somebody did. That's awesome. Thank you so much for coming. Oh, someone's cleaning it. Yay. Oh yeah, Fish and Sausalito is the best. I love that place. There's so many good places. And the peninsula, there's a ton of great places too. I will try to, hi. I'm on Twitter at Tara Duggan, and I will post, maybe on the food Facebook as well, we'll post the link to the stores where you can find crab. It's just a beginning because there's so many places that sell it. Thank you so much for coming, and please, thanks for being subscribers. We appreciate it. And thanks for coming, and please come back to more of our events in the future.
Thank you guys for coming.